Welcome to Point Blank, brought to you by Fitz Roofing. I'm Brandon Stranger, Sports Map Houston. That's Joel Blake. You can catch him on ESPN 97.5 and 92.5. Hey, Joel, welcome in. This week, Bruce Levine of 670 The Score in Chicago reported that sources are telling him that there is mutual interest between the Cubs and Carlos Correa. And hey, that's not a surprise because Mark Berman had previously reported that the Cubs were one of the teams that reached out to Correa's camp prior to the lockout. Now, Levine's source is telling him that the sticking point is, wait for it, the length of the deal. The Cubs don't want to, the Cubs don't want to agree to a 10-year deal. So here we go, Joel. Here's another team that's squeamish about committing to a 10-year contract. That's how the Dodgers lost Seager to the Rangers. They offered 8. Texas went 10. Seager went to Texas. But the pattern with these long-term deals is typically that bad teams have to overpay to land a star. And so I guess my question to you is this. You take this information, combine it with Buster Olney's report that, you know, the Tigers offered Correa that 10-year deal. What's your gut telling you about where Correa lands up? Not necessarily location, but is he going to go to a team where he's going to have to compromise on a deal as far as length or amount? Or is he going to end up taking a big deal from a bad team to go grab that bag?
I think the only team he makes concessions for is the Astros, simply because he knows the one thing that's built into the Astros is a winning culture, a place that he knows like the back of his hand that he's been a part of, that he can continue to build and grow with, and then hopefully that can continue to be longer and longer term deals, or he can earn more and more along the way. I think other than that, he's going to have to make the concession, I'm going to a bad team. Maybe it's in a big market like Chicago, or maybe the Yankees do overpay, but the overpayment is going to have prices and consequences as well, and that's going to be part of his decision, because I don't think you can have it all. I don't think that the Yankees are as realistic as everybody thinks they are, because they already have so many big-time deals, and they have Aaron Judge they still have to sign. I don't know that the Dodgers are going to be a factor, because they already had a trade last year that built in their shortstop to replace Seager, so they don't have to make any moves if they don't want to, and their payroll is huge. So I don't know if he's going to get the ultimate wish list. What he's going to have to determine is, do I want to get that extra big-time cash that I always wanted and that bag, as you say? Or is there a happy medium where I can still get a majority of the money but do it with a winning team where I'm going to be more prevalent on a daily basis when I'm doing well and maybe capitalize more outside of just playing baseball with some of the other endorsements and things he can get? It's a tough decision for him and his family and his agent, but it's going to be one way or the other, I believe.
There's a quote that Correa made to a Chicago media outlet that I think is pretty applicable to this conversation, and we'll get into that. But before we do, tell us about Fitz Roofing.
We love Fitz Roofing. Look, any time of year when you need someone that can be there and tell you what they can do and how they can help you and it doesn't cost you anything, you go to Fitz Roofing. Because Fitz Roofing, from a roof repair to a whole new roof on your business or your home to home repairs or a new fence in your yard, they take care of you. It starts with that free, no obligation inspection. 832-521-3001. They'll come to you and tell you what they can do, cost you nothing, and you know if you go with them, you'll get the best in the business. Fitz Roofing, making a difference one home at a time.
So back in October, NBC Sports had an exclusive interview with Correa. I mean, I'll just paraphrase what he said, but essentially they were talking about these long-term deals, and he said that the 10-year deals have typically gone to guys who are in their 30s. And he says, I'm 27. I'm healthy and I can perform. And so he feels like he's worth it. And so I guess my question is, does that quote tell you that that 10-year deal is a line in the sand for him?
I think it's a sticking point, but I don't know that it's going to be the end all be all. I think cooler heads should prevail at a certain point and go, look, one of the other benefits of being only 27 is you don't have to have it and realize this is the last chance at a big time deal. If you can live up to it and bet on yourself as you did last season, and continue to perform, there will be other opportunities for you to make money. You also have to balance the endorsements, the cost of living, state tax, and other things to realize there's ways to get around it. But I think, Brandon, the really tightrope of a line that he's walking is you can take a short-term deal, because Buster Olney was also getting into that. Would he take 2 and 70 and maybe a little extra on the average annual income, the AAI, or would he look to that 10-year deal but have to take less to do it, similar to what the Tigers were offering? And is there a happy medium? I think that Correa is in a position where if he took 6 or 7, the Astros might be in that ballgame to at least compete, and he would also still be in line for at least one more deal. It might be another, not another max deal, but who knows where contracts will be at that point, to where at the end of it, when you monetize it and say, hey, over the 10-year period, Unlike Dallas Keuchel, who ended up making much less by gambling on himself, Correa could say, hey, prices went through the roof. TV deals were good. I made more, but stayed where I wanted to play and played at a, in a better location for me. It's possible, and that's something that he's got to factor in as well. It can't be small picture for a big bag. It has to be big picture for the overall bottom line that could end up being the best deal for Carlos Correa.
And obviously, how much winning he wants to do weighs into this as well, which leads me to my last question for you, which is, you know, there is that conversation. There is that possibility of maybe, you know, we saw him bet on himself this year and, you know, not sign that long-term extension before the year, bet on himself and put himself in a position to where now he is the top coveted free agent, specifically at shortstop, but he is one of the top free agents. Will he do that again? And if he does so, like you said, if he, you know, gambles and says, let me do a short term, a 2 or 3 year deal, which is at a really, really high average per, if he were to do that, do you think it's more likely in that scenario that he does stay in Houston?
I do. I think it's the best case scenario for him. Then you would see one of the big teams compete, whether it be LA, New York, or Houston, because those three franchises for the short term are going to be relevant in the chase for a World Series championship. After that, all bets are off. Who are the Astros going to be able to keep? Are they going to be able to re-sign Tucker and Yordan and some of the young pitching? Are the Yankees going to be able to keep healthy the guys that they're paying a lot of money to and still put players around them? Are the Dodgers in the same boat, going to be able to keep their veterans and their big contract guys healthy and performing? And then are they going to be able to add and fortify their rosters? Short-term, yes. Long-term, we don't know. But we do know the long-term with the other teams that are in the running are probably going to be mediocre, middle-of-the-road teams where you're not going to get the extra benefit of playoff money and extra monetary things from endorsements as you get to the national stage more and more. So I think those are things he has to weigh in. But if he wants to win in the short term, that's where if you're an Astros fan, you keep your fingers crossed that there's still hope, whether it be a short-term to middle-term deal, that you can still get the money, capitalize on the winning for now, and still look forward to one more contract down the road.